So yeah, sir, the post-World War chess international scene needs champions.
Exactly.
And FIDE shows up and says, well, we're going to organize this, and the age of the private world championships end.
That's precisely right.
They have this match tournament. Botvinnik wins the tournament ahead of everybody. And then that starts a real reign of dominance for this one player.
No question about it. So FIDE comes into being more or less 1924. And a lot of people kind of ignore FIDE, at least as far as the World Chess Championship is concerned. But the problem is Alekhine dies as the reigning world champion. So now others have to put together the whole world championship cycle and to make it a continuum that constantly succeeds. So they started with the five players for the world championship. It's like that Botvinnik wins. And then they make these matches and the whole candidates.
You know, the
channels
of candidates and interzonals.
And that all of that comes
seemed so natural back in that time period.
Was all new.
Was all brand new.
Brand new. And this post-World War II chess experience was really the hegemony of the Soviets. Botvinnik becomes the guy.
So Moscow becomes the capital of world championships.
No, ten world championships
get played in Moscow only, but Botvinnik is in seven of them.
Please.
It's like home turf every time he plays.
Absolutely. So he starts, of course, with a 12-12 draw. He retains his
against
world championship against Bronstein, the most creative genius ever.
Wow, then comes some arguments over that, maybe, but yes,
David is
Tal might get thrown in there, but
we're coming in. But then we go to Smyslov. Smyslov upsets Botvinnik, but then loses the rematch. And the rematch
was a tie first, though. It was first the tie. Then upsets Botvinnik, and then
rematch. Now the rematch clause. That's the thing that sticks in a lot of people's craw. Hey, look, you're the champ. If I beat you,
I'm the champ.
Are we going to constantly be perpetually calling for a rematch against ourselves whenever we lose? But the rematch clause is what keeps Botvinnik in his throne. And it comes to 1960, and another, like Capablanca, force of nature is created. But this time, instead of this beautiful, positional, exquisite, harmonic play, we get chaos on some quantum level.
I thought you were going to say kick-ass.
Yeah.
Came with the wood. He was dropping bombs on people. The way he played, Tal's my favorite player of all time. You watch the way he played chess. Nobody thought you could play chess like that. Not at the world championship level.
Absolutely not.
And win the title.
No.
This guy didn't care about chess pieces. It didn't look like he cared about queens even. Just like, whatever I can sack, I'm just going to sack. I'm going to mate you. They would find out it was unsound afterwards, and he'd say, who cares? I'm just trying to crush you. Did you find it at the board? Don't tell me what you found back home.
6 months later.
I mean, it really sometimes took months. We didn't have computers back then, so it took months to refute some of his sacrifices.
Exactly.
He was just absolutely incredible, and he knocked Botvinnik for a loop in game one.
Like,
right away, boom, your French defense, take that out of here. Botvinnik switched to the caro.
Right.
This guy's crazy. He's wild. I can't handle him in that, and started going more solid after that.
Force of nature. Just undeniable force of nature. Quantum chaos, tactics galore. Mikhail Tal, the youngest world champion ever.
At the time, 24 years old.
Yeah. Unbelievable. But because when we think about world champions and Steinitz and Botvinnik,
you could be in your 50s and be world champion.
Now you're getting youthful. Now, 1960, that was huge. But Botvinnik got that rematch clause.
Yeah, that rematch clause. And you know, Botvinnik also felt like he didn't really lose that match to Tal. There were some positions he felt like he could have outplayed him.
Yeah.
He did start outplaying him near the end.
Right.
But the lead was so big already that
he'd been overwhelmed.
Was just overwhelming. And
that's
Tal played some amazing game.
Magic.
It's like, I think game six, he had the black pieces and he played this wild King's Indian, put a knight on F4, said, take it, I don't care.
Yeah.
Go right ahead.
Right.
And for him, it was all about what he called taking his opponents into the jungle where 2 + 2 = 5.
Right.
And the way out is only one guy coming out.
Right, right. Yeah, that the was path was very, was very narrow.
Very slim.
Yeah.
And so, but then in 61, Botvinnik had figured it out and said, I'm not going to play that same craziness. I'm going to watch you. And also tolerate a little bit of illness as well.
This is the big problem. This is the big problem. Misha was one of those players. He loved the bottle. There was not a single party that he never said no.
He also was doing 50, 60 cigarettes a day.
Oh, yeah.
And that, I mean, how do you do that and pull that off?
In some of the games I played with Michael, when he was smoking a cigarette and he was taking a deep drag, he was already lighting another one, forgetting the fact that he already had a cigarette in his hand. So, he was definitely, carton every 2 days kind of thing.
And I remember,
a big drinker.
And I remember this reading this, which is kind of a wild thing, that he had some kind of illness. I know he had renal, kidney issues as well. But when he'd have a problem, the way he'd cure it was by drinking.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, nowadays, right, sounds farcical.
Like what?
Using alcohol.
Right, yeah.
But
using alcohol to knock out whatever virus or germ you may have. Yeah.
But he definitely was a darling to many. The games that he produced, even after he lost the title to Botvinnik, were still fantastic. His unbeaten streak of so many games was a real champion. But he was really one of those, as far as the World Championship's concerned, meteorite.
Absolutely.
Came and burned and disappeared, but left such an indelible memory on all of us.
No question, absolutely. And there's so many stories, and they're each and every one of them wonderful in their own way. Two very quick ones. When he lost the World Championship title, his humanitarian spoke out when he said, well, now the Soviet school children are all very happy when I lost the World Championship. Now, instead of learning how to sacrifice their pawns and pieces, they could go back to learning how to defend them. And that made them all very, very happy. He was a humanitarian, too. He was just a beautiful, beautiful person.
And also a great writer. Will just say, if you haven't read Talbot Vinnick 1960, get it now.
Exactly.
What a treat that book is. That written by Tal himself, a lyrical book by an epic world champion.
I just felt like I was right at his elbow side when he played that match. And the second one is he's in Moscow, as is his common. He's in a hospital. He's suffering something. And he's told that night at the Moscow Central Chess Club, Garry Kasparov, the world champion's playing in the Blitz Championship at the Moscow Central Chess Club. The guy's got tubes. He's in the hospital nightgown. He slips out of the hospital, goes and plays in the tournament, and beats Garry Kasparov. From his hospital bed!
That was tall.
Maurice!
Vintage.
Come on!
Vintage tall. Well, of course, he couldn't handle Botvinnik. Botvinnik then goes on, plays Petrosian, loses. But Botvinnik had his big reign. Tall certainly had his magical year, and those two great champions we'll never forget.
Never.